out to the broil to start to sleep.
Downward, student, as two spent swimmers that do cling together and choke their art. The merciless MacDonald, and worthy to be called rebel, for to that the multiplied villainies of nature do swarm upon him. From the western isles of currency, gallant vices is supplied, and fortune on his damned course finally shows like a rebel's whore. But all's too weak. For brave Macbeth, with his brandished spear, which smoke with bloody execution, my valor's minion carved out his passage till he faced the slave, which there shook hands to bid farewell to him till he had seen him from the nave to the chaps, and fixed his head upon the battlements.
Oh, valiant cousin, worthy gentleman.
But I'm faint. Ashes, I fell!
So well thy words become thee as thy wounds, a smack of honor, but go, get him, surgeons. Who comes here?
The worthy thane of Ross.
God save the king.
Whence camest thou, worthy thane?
From the five great king, where the Norwegian banners plough the sky and fan our people cold. Norway himself, with terrible numbers, assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the thane of Cawdor, began a dismal conflict. Till that the honest bride, lapped in proof, confronted him with self-comparison. Point against point, rebellious, arm against arm, curdling with lavish spirit. And to conclude, the victory fell on us.
Great happiness!
Then now Sweno, Norway's king, craves composition. Nor would we pay him burial of his men till he dispersed at St. Colm's Inch $10,000 to our general use.
No more of that thane of Cawdor shall receive our blows of interest. Go, pronounce his present death. With his former title, greet Macbeth.
I'll see it done.
What he had lost, noble Macbeth won.
Favors, nor your hate.
Hail. Lesser than men.
fit state.
What substance here does you speak about? Have we eaten all the insane root that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
A thing of Cotter too. When and not so.
This is all the same too, the words. Who's here?
The king has happily received Macbeth news of thy success.
And when he reads thy personal venture in the rebels' fight, his wonders and his praises do contend which be thine or his. As thick as hail came post with post, and every one did bear thy name in his kingdom's great defense, and poured them down before him. And we are sent to give thee from our royal master thanks, only to herald thee into his sight, not pay. And for an earnest of a greater honor, he bade me from him call thee Thane of Cottle, in which addition, hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine. What, can the devil speak truth?
The Thane of Cotter lives. Why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who was the Thane is yet, but treason's capital. Confessed and proved have overthrown it.
Well, I'm some Thane of Cotter. Greatest is behind. Thanks for your pains.
Do not hope your children to be kings. When those that gave the Thane of Cotter to me promised no less than that. That trusted hall might yet enkindle you unto the crown, besides the Thane of Caldor. But 'tis strange, and oftentimes to win us to our harm, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles to betray us in deepest consequence. Cousins, a word, I pray you.
Two truths are told. This happy prologue to the swelling act of the imperial feet.
I thank you, gentlemen.
Commencing in a truth, I am Thane of Cotter. If good, why do I yield to that suggestion whose horrid image does unfix my hair and make my seated heart knock at my ribs against the use of nature? Present fears are less than horrible imaginings. My thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical, shakes so my single state of man that function is smothered in surmise, and nothing is but what is not.
Look how our heart is wrapped.
If chance may have me king, but chance may crown me without my stir.
New honors come upon him like our strange garments. We wrapped in their moment with the aid of use.
Come what come may, time and the hour runs through the roughest day.
Worthy Macbeth, we stay upon your ledger.
Give me your favor, my whole brain was wrought with things forgot. Let us toward the king. Think upon what it chanced, and at more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts each to other.
Very gladly.
Till then, enough.
Come, friends!
Is execution done on Potter? Are not those in commission yet returned?
At least they are not yet come back. But I have spoken with one that saw him die, who did report that very frankly he confessed his treason, implored your highness's pardon, and set forth a deep repentance. Nothing in his life became him like the leaving it. He died as one that had been studied in his death, to throw away the dearest thing he owed as for a careless trifle.
There's no art to find the mind's construction in the face. He was a gentleman on whom I built an absolute trust.
Macbeth!
Macbeth! Oh, worthiest cousin, the sin of my ingratitude even now was heavy on me. Only I have left to say, more is thy due than more than all can pay.
The service and the loyalty I owe in doing it pays itself.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee and will labor to make thee full of growing. Noble Banquo, that has no less deserved, nor must be known no less to have done so, let me enfold thee and hold thee to my heart.
There if I grow, the harvest is your own.
Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and you whose places are the nearest, know. We will establish our estate upon our own. Now, whom we name hereafter the Prince of Cumberland, which honor must not unaccompanied invest him only, but signs of nobleness like stars shine on all deserves. From hence us to Inverness, and bind us further to you.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be myself the harbinger, and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
My worthy caller.
The Prince of Cumberland. That is a step on which I must fall down, or else or leap, for in my way it lies. Stars, hide your fires. Let not light see my black and deep desires.
Met me in the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they hold more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air, into which they vanished. Whilst I stood wrapped in the wonder of it, came missives from the king, who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor, by which title before these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with hail king that shall be. This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised. Lay it to thy heart and farewell. Hamzawat, Cawdor, and shalt be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great. Art not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. But thou wouldst highly, thou wouldst thou boldly, wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou'st had great wrong. That which cries, thus thou must do, if thou have it, and that which rather thou dost fear to do than wish should be undone. That I may pour my spirits in thine ear and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden crown, which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned with all. What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him who, were so, would have informed for preparation?
So please you, it is true, our thane is coming. What of my fellows that speed at him, almost dead for breath, that scarce one would make up his message?
Give him tenure. He brings great news. The raven himself is hoarse. It croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits. Attend on mortal. Sex me here, and fill me from the crown to the toe top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood. Stop up the access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my felt purpose, nor keep peace between the effect of it. Come to my woman's breasts, you murdering monster. Wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come thick night, and pall thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen eyes see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold. Great love, worthy Cawdor. Greater than both, let me all hail hereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
Dearest brother, Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow is the purposes.
Oh, never shall sun let morrow see. Your face, my thing, is as a book where men may read strange manners. Look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent of it. He that's coming must be prepared for, and you shall put this night's great
things into my dispatch, which shall for all our nights and days to come give sole and sovereign sway and master.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear. Leave all the rest to me.
This castle hath a pleasant seat. The air nimbly and sweetly recommends itself unto our gentle senses. See our honored hostess. The love that follows us sometimes is our trouble, which still we thank as love. Herein I teach you how you shall bid God illness for your pains and thank us for your trouble.
All out of service, twice done and then done double, were poor and single business to contend against those honors.
Broad, where
with your majesty
goes our house. Where is the Thane of Cawdor? We coursed him at the heels and had a purpose to be his purveyor, but he rides well, and his great love, sharp as his spur, hath opened to his home before us. Fair and noble hostess, we are your guests tonight. Give me your hand. Conduct me to mine host. We love him highly and shall continue our graces toward him. By your leave.
Done what is done. We got well, we're done quickly. If the assassination could trammel up the consequence and catch with his surcease success, that but this blow might be the be all and the end all here. But here, upon this bank and shore of time, we jump the life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here. That we would teach bloody instructions which, being taught, return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poison chalice to our own lips. He's here in double trust. First, as I am his kinsman and his subject, strong both against the deed. That is his host. Who should against the murderer shut the door and not bear the knife on himself? Besides, this Duncan hath borne his faculties so deep, hath been so clear in his great office, his virtues shall plead like angels, trumpet tongue against the deep damnation of his taking off. And pity, like a naked newborn babe striding the blast, or heaven's cherubim, forced upon the sightless couriers of the year, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye, that tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of mine intent, but only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls on the other. Oh no, what news?
He is almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
No, not he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me with, and I have had gold opinions from all sorts of people which should be worn now in their newest loss, not cast aside so soon.
Is the hope drunk wherein you dress yourself? Have it slept, sis, and wakes it now to look so green and pale at what it did so. From this time, such I count thy love. Art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteemst the ornament of life, and live a coward in thine own esteem? Let it, I dare not, wait upon, I would, like the poor caveat.
Pretty peace. I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares do more is none.
What beast was it then that made you break the set price to me? When you durst do it, then you were a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more than man. Nor time, nor place, than if you're yet they would be both. You have, they have made themselves. And now their fitness now does unmake you. I have given suck. And know how tender tis to love the babe that knows me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from its boneless gums and dashed the brains out had I so sworn as you have done to this.
If we should fail!
Fail! But screw your courage to the sticking place and will not. Dares receive it other, as we shall make our griefs and clamor roar upon his death.
I'm settled. And bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away, and mock the time with fairest show. False face must hide what false heart doth know.
Summons lies like lead upon me, and yet I would not sleep. Merciful powers, restraining me, the cursed thoughts that nature gives way to in repose.
Give me my sword. Who's that?
A friend.
What, sir? Now get at rest. The king's in bed. He has been an unusual pleasure, and sent forth great largesse to your offices. This diamond, you reach your wife as well, by the name of Most Kind Hostess. And shut off and measure its contents.
Being unprepared, our will was made subject to defect, which else should free abroad.
All's well. I dreamt last night of the three weird sisters. To you that had showed some truth.
I think not of them.
Yet, when we can entreat an hour to serve, we will spend it in some words upon that business, if you would not be kind. At your kind's leisure.
Good repose the while.
Thanks, sir. The like to you.
Go. Bid thy mistress, when my drink is ready, she strike upon the bell.
Get thee to bed. Dagger which I see before me, the handle toward my hand. Come, let me clutch thee. I have thee not, and yet I see thee still. Art thou not fatal vision, sensible feeling as to sight?
Or art thou but
false creation, proceeding from the heat-oppressive brain. I see thee yet, in form as palpable as this which now I draw.
Thou marshalst me the way that I was going. And such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes made the fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest.
I see thee still. And on thy blade and dudgeon, gouts of blood, which was not so before.
There's no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes.
Nature seems dead, and wicked dreams abuse the curtained sleep. Thou sure and firm set earth, hear not my steps, which way they walk, for fear thy very stones prate of my whereby, and take the present horror from the time which now suits with it. Whilst I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds, too cold breath gives. I go, and it is done. The bell invites me. Hear not, Duncan. For it is a knell which summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire.
Shh.
Is that not here, Norse?
I heard the owl scream and the crickets cry. Did not you speak?
What?
Now?
As I've said it.
Ah!
Hark! Who lies in the second chamber?
Thou only.
This is a sorry sight.
Foolish thought to say it's ours.
As one did laugh and sleep, and one cried murder, but they did wake each other. I stood and heard them, but they did say their prayers and addressed them again to sleep. One cried, God bless us, and amen the other, as they had seen me with these hangman's hands. Listening to that fear, I could not say amen when they did say God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could I not pronounce amen? I had most need of blessing, and amen stuck in my throat.
These deeds must not be thought after this way, so it will make us men.
A voice cries, sleep no more. Macbeth does murder sleep. The innocent sleep. Sleep that lights up the rattled sleep of care. The death of each day's life. Sore labor's death. Balm of hurt minds. Chief nourisher of life's feast.
What do you mean?
Still the cry, sleep no more to all the house. Glaubs hath murdered sleep. And therefore Cotter shall sleep no more. Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that thus cried? Why, why do you fain you do unbend your noble strength to please so bright and sickly a face? Go get some water, then wash this filthy witness from your hands. Why did you bring these daggers from the place? They must lie there. Go carry them and spare the sleeping.
No, 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 no more!
gild the faces of the grooms with all, for it must seem their guilt.
Whence is that knocking?
How is it with me when every noise appalls me? What hands are these? They pluck out my eyes. Will all great Neptune's ocean wash this blood clean from my hand? No. This my hand, or rather the multitudinous seas incarnate, making the green one red.
Shame to wear a heart so white. Is it not even the sun that drinks? Retire into our chamber. A little water clears us of this deed. How easy is it then? Your constancy had left you unattended. Mark! Put on your nightgown. Lest occasion call us and show us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To know my deed, for thus not know myself.
Wake Duncan with thy knocking!
Is a knocking indeed. The man the porter of Hellgate, he should have old turning the key. Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? It's a farmer that hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Oh, come in time. Have napkins enough about you. Hear your sweat for it. Knock, knock. Who's there in the other devil's name? Oh, faith. He's an equivocator. One that could swear in both the scales against either scale, who committed treason enough, for God's sake, yet could not equivocate to heaven. Oh, come in, equivocator. Knock, knock. What are you? Ah, this place is too cold for help. I'll devil porter it no further. I had thought to let in some of all professions that go the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire. Anon, anon! I pray you, remember the porter?
Was it so late, friend? I heard you went to bed, but you devised so late.
Faith, sir, we were carousing until the second cock. And drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Oh, marry, sir. Nose painting, sleep, and urine. Naturally, sir, it provokes and unprovokes. It provokes the desire, but takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes him and it mars him. It sets him on, and it takes him off. It persuades him, and it disheartens him. It makes him stand to, and not stand to. In conclusion, equivocates him in a sleep, and giving him the lie, leaves him.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
Well, that it did, sir. In the very throat on me, but I requited him for his life. And I think being too strong for him, although he took out my...
time. Yet, I made a shift to cast him.
Is thy master stirring? Ah, the late Baron Otten has awakened him.
Good morrow, noble sir.
Good morrow, both. Is the king stirring, or anything?
Not yet.
He did bid me call time to him. I have nearly slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
I know this is a joyful trouble for you, but get this one.
The labor we delight in physics pay.
This is the door. I shall make so bold to call. Tis my limited service. Goes the king hence today?
He does. He did appoint so.
Time has been unruly. Where we lay, our chimneys were blown down. And as they say, lamentings heard in the air. Strange screams of death and prophesying with accents terrible, of dire combustion and confused events, new hatched to the woeful time. The obscure bird clamored the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverish and shake.
It was a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel a fellow to it.
Oh, horror! 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 Thunder heart cannot conceive nor name thee!
What's the matter?
Confusion now hath made his masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke open the Lord's anointed temple and stole thence the life of the building.
What does he say, the life?
I mean you, his majesty! Approach the chamber and destroy your sight of the new border. Do not bid me speak, see, and then speak yourselves. Awake! Awake! Ring the alarm bell! Murder and treason! Make war gone away! Malcolm! Up! Awake! Look at what happens up! Up, up and see!
Contradict myself and say it is not so.
But I haven't died an hour before this chance. I've lived a blessed time. But from this instant, there's nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys. Renown and grace is dead. The wine of life is drawn, and the mere leaves is left this gulp to brag of.
What is amiss?
You are, and do not know. The spring, the head, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father is murdered. By whom?
Those of his chamber, as it seemed, had done it. Their hands and faces were all badged with blood, as were the daggers which unlikely bound upon the pillows. They stared and were distracted. No man's life was to be trusted with them.
Yet I do repent me of my fury, that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, temperate and furious, loyal and neutral in an instant? No man. The expedition of my violent love outrun the pause of reason. There lay Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood. His gashed stabs look like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. They're the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love, and in that heart, courage to make love know?
Help me hence.
Why do we hold our tongues that most may claim this argument for ours?
What should be spoken? Here, where our fate hidden augur hold, may Russian seize us. Let's away, our tears are not yet brewed,
nor our strong sorrow on the foot of motion.
Look to the lady, and when we have our naked frailties hid that suffer in exposure, let us meet and question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fears and scruples shake us. In the great hand of God I stand. And thence against the undivulged pretense, I fight with treasonous malice.
So do I.
So all!
Priest, you put on manly readiness and be the whole together. Well, content.
What will you do? Let's not consult. Show an unfelt sorrow is an office which the false man does easy. Up to England.
Tired and die. Where
and let us not be dainty of thee taking but shift away.
There's warrant in that theft which steals itself when there's no mercy left.
Threescore and ten I can remember well, within the volume of which time there has been hours dreadful and things strange. But this sword knight hath trifled former knowings.
Ah, good father, thou seest the heavens as troubled with man's act threaten this bloody stage. By clock 'tis day, and yet dark night strangles the traveling lamp. This night's predominance or the day's shame, that darkness does the face of earth entomb when living light should kiss it.
'Tis unnatural, even like the deep that's dug. On Tuesday last, a falcon towering in her private place was harked at by a mousing owl and killed.
And Duncan's horses, a thing most strange and certain, turned wild in nature, broke loose their stalls, flung out, contending against obedience as they would make war with mankind.
'Tis said they eat each other.
They did so, to the amazement of mine eyes that looked upon it. But here comes the good duck.
How goes the world, sir, now?
Why, see you not?
Is known who did this more than bloody deed?
Those that Macbeth hath slain.
Alas, the day, what good could they pretend?
They were suborned. Malcolm and Donalbain, the king's two sons, are stolen away and fled, which casts upon them a suspicion of the deed.
Then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
He's already named, and gone to Scone to be invested.
Where's Duncan's body?
Carried to Calm Killer.
Will you to Scone?
No, cousin. I'll provide him.
Well, I will thither.
May you see things well done there. Adieu. Lest our old road sit easier than our new.
Farewell, Father. God's venison go with you, and with those that would make good for bad and friends of foe. Fears in Bancor stick deep, and in his royalty of nature reigns that which would be free.
bade them speak to him. And prophet-like, they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a purpleless crown and put a barren scepter in my grip, thence to be wrenched with an unlineal hand, no son of mine succeeding. If it be so, for Banquo's issue have I filed my mind. For them the gracious Duncan have I murdered, put rancors in the vessel of my peace, only for them, and mine eternal jewel, given to the common enemy of man, to make them kings, the seed of Banquo kings. Rather than so, come fading to the utterance and champion me. Who's there? Now go to the door and stay there till we call. Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
It was, so please, Your Highness.
Well, then. Know that it was he in the times past which held you so under fortune, which you thought had been our innocent self. This I made good to you in our last conference, passed in probation with you. How you were born in hand, how crossed, the instruments, who wrought with them, and all things else which might to half a soul or to a notion crazed say, thus did Banquo.
You made it known to us.
I did so. And went further, which is now our point of setting you. Do you find your patience so predominant in nature that you can let this go? Are you so gospel to pray for this good man and for his issue, whose heavy hand hath bowed you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my liege.
In the catalogs go for them. As hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, all by the name of dogs, and so with men. Now, if you have a station in the file, not for the worst kind of capital, say it. And I will put that business in your bosoms, whose execution takes your enemy off, grapples you to the heart and love of us, who wear a helmet sickly in his life, which in his death were perfect.
I am one man, whom the vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed. I reckless what I can despite the world, and I another, so weary with disasters, tugged with fortune, that I have set my life on any chance to mend it or be rid of it.
Both of you know Banquo was your enemy.
True, my lord.
So is he mine. And in such bloody distance that every minute of his being thrust at my nearest of life. And though I could with bare-faced power sweep him from my sight and bid my will avouch him, I must not. For certain friends that are both his and mine, whose loves I may not drop, who I myself struck down. And thence it is that I to your assistance do make love, masking the business from the common eye for sundry weighty reasons.
We shall, my lord, perform what you command.
Though our lives be
ours.
Your spirits shine through. Within this hour most, I will advise you where to plant yourselves. Acquaint you with perfect spy of the time, the moment on, for it must be done tonight. And something from the palace. Always thought that I required clearness. Fleance his son, whose absence is no less valuable to me than is his father's, must embrace the fate of that dark hour. Resolve yourself apart. I'll come to you and all.
You're resolved, my lord.
I'll call upon you straight. Goodbye, your favor.
Not sad. All sped.
suffer ere we will eat our meal in fear and sleep in the affliction of these terrible dreams which shake us nightly. Better be with the dead, whom we, to gain our peace, have sent to peace, than on the torture of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. Duncan is in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst. Nor seal, nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further.
Come on. Gentle, my lord. Sleek o'er your rugged looks. Be bright and jovial among your guests tonight.
So shall I, love. So I pray to you. Let your remembrance apply to Banquo. Present him his eminence, both I and Tom. Unsafe the while, that we must lave our honors in these flattering streams and make our faces visits to our hearts, disguising what they are.
We must leave this.
Oh, full of scorpions is my mind, your wife! Scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale. Life thickens, and the crow makes wing to the rooky wood. Good things of day do droop and drowse, while night's black
saucy doubts and fears. But back more safe.
Aye, my lord, safe in the ditch he lies. The 20 trench gashes on his head, the leaves that left the nature.
Thanks for that. The other grown serpent lies. The worm that's fled hath nature in him that will venom breed. No teeth for the present. Get thee gone. Tomorrow we'll hear ourselves again.
My royal lord, you do not get the cheer.
Sweet remembrance, sir. Now good digestion wait on appetite, and health on both.
May it please your highness said.
Here had we now our country's honor roof, where the graced person of our banquet present, who may I rather challenge for unkindness than pity for mischance.
His absence, sir, lays blame upon his promise. Please, your highness, to grace us with your royal company.
The table's full.
Here's the seat reserved, sir.
Where?
Here, my good lord. What is it, do, sir, highness?
Which of you have done this?
What, my good lord?
Now, please not say I did it. Never shake that door locked in me.
Gentlemen, rise. His highness is not well.
I pray you keep seat. My lord, often thus and have been from his youth. Pray you, the fifth moment. Upon God he will again be well. If my lord shall then man extend his passion, fee and regard him not. Are you a man?
I am bold. The devil come out of my cold devil.
Stop. This is the very painting of your fear. This is the air contact from which you set led you to darkness. Shame itself. Why do you make such faces when all is done you will put on a stool?
Ready. See there. Behold. Look. No. What say you? Why, what care I? If thou canst not speak to. If charnel houses and our graves must yield those that we bury back, our monuments shall be the laws of Christ.
Quick,
if I stand here, wait for
you!
Blood has been shed ere now. The times have been that when the brains were out, the man would die, and there an end. But now the rest yet. 20 immortal murders on their crowns and pushes from our stools. This is more strange than such a murder is.
My worthy lord, your noble friends do lack you.
I do forget. Do not use of me, most worthy friends. I have a strange infirmity which is nothing to those that know me. Come, love and help to all, then I'll sit down. Give me some wine. Fill full. I drink a general joy to the whole table, and to our friend Banquo, whom we miss. Would he were here. To all and him we thirst, and all to all.
Duty and
the pledge. Come on! And quit my sight! Hunt the earth by me! betimes I will to the weird sisters. More shall they speak, for now I am meant to know by the worst means the worst. I am in blood stepped in so far that should I wait no more, returning were as tedious as gore. Strange things I have in head that will to hand, which must be acted ere they may be scanned.
You lack the season of all nature.